Good afternoon. My name is Bob Glenn, and it is my privilege and honor to be the president here at Athens State University and to be the one to welcome you to this commencement ceremony. Can we have another round of applause for Dr. Joe Brasher, Emeritus Professor of Education, for his work with our company? Since for many of you this will be your first exposure to a formal academic convocation, we thought it might be helpful if we spend just a moment before we start talking about the significance of the ritual and symbolism that you are about to encounter. We are about to engage in a ritual that is 194 years old on our campus, and in higher education goes back almost 1,000 years. In your program, you'll find a brief description of the history of academic regalia. What is not included in your program is the reason why we choose to wear these robes on this occasion. The wearing of academic robes goes back to medieval times, when a person's dress clearly designated who that person was. It was an absolute expression of not only who you were, but also of your station in society. When you looked at a person, you knew instantly everything you needed to know about whom you were meeting and how you were expected to respond to that person. At that time, there were no universities and there were no libraries. Books were a scarce commodity, and consequently so was knowledge. Possessing knowledge was possessing power. Coming into possession of knowledge was one of the few ways that a person could move up in a world with a rigid caste society. If one was able to learn how to read, then the next obstacle to overcome would be finding the books. And there were only two places to find those books, monasteries and private libraries. Monasteries were the only place where books could be accessed by someone who was not of noble birth. Men who wanted to seek after knowledge and better their lot in life came to the monastery to find it. In most cases, these seekers of knowledge were young clerics. They became a part of the monastery in order to have access to the knowledge that they sought. They were required to wear the clerical robe as a declaration to the community and the world of the path they had chosen. In doing so, they did more than simply declare their identity. They also assumed certain responsibilities to everyone that they would encounter. To put on a robe was a life-changing event. A person who put on the robe of a cleric was committing himself to serve others as well as himself. As time progressed, the wearing of robes became increasingly symbolic. As universities developed an identity separate from the monastery, the meaning of the robe changed. The academic robes you see today became associated with teaching. But even in change, the real meaning of the robe remained basically the same. The wearing of the academic robe by our faculty is still an expression of who we are and what purpose we are supposed to serve in society. It carries with it certain obligations. Concepts like academic integrity and service are an inherent part of accepting a place in the community of scholars. When we wear the regalia, we are still saying to society that we are seekers of knowledge, that we are here to serve others as well as ourselves, and that we recognize our obligation to those who are present with us here today. 1,000 years ago, when a cleric put on a robe, he was saying that he was a new person, a member of a new community. Today, your graduates are donning their robes to proclaim to you that they are a different person. Today, they become a graduate, a full member of this community of scholars. When a cleric put on the robe, it was a life-changing event for him. Your graduate dons his or her robe in the same hope that it will change their life as well. Just like all the clerics of old and all the students who have passed through the halls of academia since then, and all the graduates of this institution over the last 194 years, your graduate has worked long and hard to get to this day. And when they march out in that robe, they will be celebrating that accomplishment. The ritual of commencement gives us a root as an institution. It connects us with the rich heritage of the past while also opening up the horizon of the future. Your presence here today represents the roots from which these graduates come. Roots give us nourishment, they sustain us, and they give us stability. Your presence here today gives each graduate a connection to who they are and gives us a reason to come together to celebrate where they are going next. So, in honor of 1,000 years of tradition in higher education, in honor of 194 years of tradition on this campus, but most importantly, in honor of the years of hard work each of these graduates have put in to get to this point, we would ask you to rise in honor of the graduates as they process into the commencement. Thank you.
Please remain standing for the invocation given by Dr. Robbie White, Assistant Professor of Religion. The invocation will be followed by the national anthem led by Ms. Carissa Lovern.
So my guess is that you maybe took roll. Some of you, maybe for the last time. I hope not. I hope you'll go on. But when with faculty take roll, most of us, the response is here. Occasionally you'll get a present. They're the same, right? To be here and to be present. Maybe not. You could be here and not be present. An invocation is an invitation to awake. The psalmist said, "Awake my soul, I will awake." To be awake is to be present, to be aware, to be here in this moment. And this is a moment. This is a moment to remember. In this moment, let us be grateful for family and friends, for colleagues and community. In this moment, let us be grateful for this occasion, a celebration of a goal accomplished, an achievement attained. In this moment, let us be grateful for this life and acknowledge that it is a gift. In this moment, let us resolve to be a blessing, to build a bridge in a world that keeps wanting to build walls, to use our education, our energy, our influence, all of our life to make this a better world. In this moment, let us put our hope in God and give thanks for this very moment. Amen.
You may be seated. At this time, I ask that you turn off all phones and other electronic devices. Welcome honored guests, friends, family, faculty, staff, and graduates to Athens State University's fall commencement. We are gathered to celebrate the accomplishments of these men and women. On this very happy occasion, we salute you, graduates. Congratulations on achieving this milestone in your life. There are others who share your joy on this special day and who were there to support you, your mothers and fathers, grandparents, spouses, children, brothers, sisters, and friends. Please join me in showing your gratitude to them for all that they have done to help you realize your goals. It is also my privilege to recognize the gifted and generous women and men, the faculty and staff of Athens State University, who walked with you through this educational experience. I invite you to join me in recognizing their efforts and in thanking them for all that they have done. Faculty. At this time, I want to recognize some individuals assisting in today's ceremony. Please stand as I recognize you. Today's commencement marshal is Dr. Ronnie Merritt, Associate Professor of Mathematics. Serving as faculty marshal is Dr. Quanda Stevenson, Assistant Professor of Criminal Justice. The mace bearer is Dr. Mark Durham, Professor of Psychology. And the student honor marshal for the College of Arts and Sciences is Keegan Milne. It is an honor to introduce you to the people on the stage today. To my right is the president of Athens State University, Dr. Bob Glenn. Our commencement speaker today is Toshio Malakasis. Our special guests include Dr. Joe Brasher, Professor Emeritus, Organist, Ms. Carissa Lovern, Vocalist, Dr. Hugh Long, Assistant Professor of English and Drama, Announcer, Dr. Ron Fritzy, Dean, College of Arts and Sciences, Dr. Keith Ferguson, Vice President for University Advancement, Mr. Mike McCoy, Vice President for Financial Affairs, Mrs. Belinda Kriegel, Associate Vice President and Chief Information Officer, Ms. Sarah Maccabee, Vice President for Enrollment and Student Support Services, Ms. Crystal Creekmore, Assistant Vice President for Enrollment Management, Dr. Robbie White, Assistant Professor of Religion. Ladies and gentlemen, it is a privilege to present the 36th President of Athens State University, Dr. Bob Glenn.
Thank you. It's my pleasure at this point to be able to do a number of special recognitions. We'd like to begin. You may have noticed as the graduates came in that many of them were wearing braids and stoles and medals, and these all represent various academic honors that we're about to recognize. But we also have a number of students who are wearing today braids that are red, white, and blue in color. And those indicate an individual who is either now in active service or is a veteran of our armed forces. So we'd like to start by asking those who are wearing the red, white, and blue cords to please stand and be recognized for your service to this great country. We thank you for your service to this country, and we thank you for allowing us to be a part of who you are. Now we'd like to recognize those who are graduating today with academic honors. You have in your program book a listing of those individuals. We'll start with those individuals who are graduating today with a 3.5 to 3.69, who are designated as graduating cum laude, or with honors. If you're graduating today cum laude, would you please stand and be recognized? Next are those individuals who have managed to maintain a 3.7 to 3.89 GPA, and they are graduating today magna cum laude, or with high honors. If you're graduating today, magna cum laude, please stand and be recognized. Thank you. And then there are those individuals who are graduating today with a 3.9 to 4.0 GPA, who are graduating summa cum laude, or with highest honors. If you're graduating today, summa cum laude, would you please stand to be recognized? We are very proud of what you've accomplished on our campus. We are proud, though, of all our graduates, and I want to particularly note all of those of you who are graduating today, just as I did 40 years ago. Thank you, Laude. We also want to recognize a member of our faculty. Now, I know that you think that your faculty have already achieved all that they can academically, but our faculty are constantly working on professional development, and I'm pleased to note today that we have a member of the faculty who has achieved a designation of holder of a doctorate. She has successfully defended her dissertation to earn her PhD. And I'd like to ask Dr. Lee Hester to stand and be recognized as Dr. Lee Hester. That is no small accomplishment, and we appreciate all that she has done. For each commencement, we try to find someone who can come before the graduates who we consider to be a role model, or role model worthy of emulation, of who is worthy of seeking the same path. And we certainly have a person that fits that description today. Today's commencement speaker has been named by Southern Living Magazine as one of the 50 people who are changing the South, one of the 75 of the most stylish Southerners, and the newly minted Big Cheese by O, the Oprah magazine. She spent 15 years in high-tech space industry with a few sabbaticals at the Culinary Institute of America. While visiting a Dean and DeLuca store in Manhattan, she picked up a cheese and was stunned to learn that the small but highly renowned creamery, Belle Chev, was located in Elkmont, Alabama, down the street from her childhood home. This chance meeting of Belle Chev in Manhattan eventually led her back home. In 2007, after quitting her job in her previous life, she worked for free for Belle Chev for 6 months, learning the art of cheesemaking, and acquired the business in 2007. Known as the goat cheese guru, she provides the strategic vision, leadership, and creativity required to ensure that the 25-year-old company continues to evolve as one of the country's most acclaimed artisan creameries. She is also the author of 2 cookbooks. It is not often that we are able to do this, but we welcome to the podium today one of Oprah's favorite people. Please welcome Ms. Taisha Malakakis.
Well, that was quite an introduction. I don't know if I'm really Oprah's favorite person or not, but I'll take it. Thank you very much. I think I should probably start by saying congratulations to all of you. It's no small feat that you've accomplished. And today, and going forward from today, you all can now say, I am a college graduate, right? It's a big deal. A college graduate is a badge of honor you can now wear as part of your identity. It's part of who you are. And I've been right where you are. I worried over the same tests that you did. I had the same anxiety dreams of failing my exams like you did. And now, by some crazy turn of events, I'm standing in front of you with the hopes of imparting some kind of wisdom that you're supposed to take into this next stage of your life. As a cheesemaker, that's kind of funny, right? It's funny to me that I'm in this position of giving you your last lecture before you receive your degree. Aren't you glad? I mean, no more lectures. It's a big deal. Your last bit of advice, maybe, probably not. You'll probably have a whole lifetime of that in front of you by well-meaning and maybe some not so well-meaning people. So I'll keep it simple. Really, I only have 3 things to say, and one, it's going to seem like a very unusual thing to say, but it doesn't matter. lesson number one, it doesn't matter. What you did yesterday, what you're doing today will not matter tomorrow. And I'm going to tell you a little story to illustrate why it doesn't matter. And it's my story. As you may know, I have a literature degree from UAH. I studied literature for one reason and one reason only. I loved it. Not because I thought I could get rich with a literature degree or that the best jobs in life were handed out to literature students. What I did get with my decision to study literature, however, was a supremely hard time. UAH, as you may know, is a very engineering-centric school, and so what I got was from most people, mostly well-meaning parents who were engineers, what are you going to do with that, right? What are you going to do with an English degree? And to be candid, I had no idea. But my thought was, as well as my response, anything I want. As you know, studying the arts prepares you for a world of options, but I had no idea that what I wanted to be was a cheesemaker. And I'm pretty sure if I did at that point that UAH probably didn't have any cheesemaking courses. I didn't check. I still haven't checked, but I'm pretty sure they don't. I didn't even know, to be quite honest with you, that cheesemaking was even on the list of options. So not knowing what I wanted to do exactly with my degree and not really caring, because again, I knew I was getting a good education, and I'll explain more about that in my second point. But I still had to make some kind of a decision because there are those pesky little things called jobs. So I took a job with a startup company that was focused on offering business intelligence on this brand new platform that was gaining traction at the time called the internet. The internet was new and exciting in the early 90s. That's probably, to some of you, look, judging by your age, you can't imagine a time where there wasn't an internet. But I enjoyed my job, and it turns out I was good at it. I stayed in that field and spent nearly 15 years in the high-tech industry, mostly in business development and management, and worked all over the country, from Silicon Valley to New York City. Lastly, in 2005, I was aggressively recruited to go to work for another startup company as their global head of product management in Philadelphia. I ran the product team, launched several new lines, and then, because of my interest, maybe, my enthusiasm, perhaps, or perhaps even some skill, I was asked to take over the marketing team and become VP of marketing as well as VP of product development. What you don't know is that I never had a course in marketing. I've never held a junior position in another company in marketing. I had no history of excellence or even failure in this space. The marketing team at the time was run by a gentleman who was highly qualified in the space. In fact, he had a master's degree in marketing from Columbia. He had education, he had experience, but for some reason, I was awarded his job. It didn't matter, which is my point. It didn't matter what I studied when I got into the field, and it didn't matter, not to me and not to my employers or even to Wall Street, what I had done before or what I had studied before. I say all of this not to illustrate the point that sometimes idiots get lucky. I say it to illustrate that no one cares what you did yesterday, and if they do, they won't be the ones from whom you learn. What matters is how you do it, which I'll address later. I consistently hire people who have no experience in my industry, and I promote cheesemakers to other areas of the business to find out where skills and interest and passion can be applied. Sarah Blakely, some of you girls may know her, founder of Spanx, a women's undergarment company, is the youngest female billionaire, the epitome of the American dream. She was selling faxes door to door when she founded Spanx. She had no knowledge of manufacturing, she had no experience in retail, and she had no idea that she was entering an industry that was experiencing a 15-year decline. It didn't matter because she didn't let that stop her. It didn't matter to her, and it didn't matter to me that I knew nothing of the food industry, that I had never made cheese, or that I had a literature degree. It won't matter to you that you just got a degree in political science when you become the next poet laureate, or if you got your master's in art history when you decide to start your own organic pet food company. It won't matter because of my second point, which is education is a tool, like a bicycle. So when I say it doesn't matter what is behind you, degrees, hardships, jobs, internships, maybe even battle for some of you, What I mean is all that does matter is your realization that you have tools. Tools with which you can create, tools which can be used for their intended purpose, political science, business administration, or for things that you cannot, as of yet, even imagine yourself doing. Steve Jobs, very soon after he made the first wave of Apple computers and was gaining traction, likened the computer to a tool for the mind, a tool that would make us better, faster, smarter. In effect, it would make us more efficient for all kinds of tasks. Tasks at the time he couldn't even imagine a computer being used for. Let me give you an example. There was a study of efficiencies of life forms in locomotion and movement. All manner of animals were studied, from those that move on the land and also includes those that move through the air. Any guesses on the winner? The most efficient in movement was, interestingly to me, the condor. The condor used the least energy to move a kilometer. Even more interesting to me is that humans didn't fare so well in coming in the lower percentile. Not so good for the king of beasts, right? But then somebody at Scientific American tested the efficiency of a human on a bicycle. Seems like cheating in a way. But what has always set us apart as humans is our ability to develop and use tools. As you might imagine, even being in the lower percentile, a human on a bicycle was completely off the charts, over and above the most efficient animal, the condor. Steve Jobs used this analogy to describe how computers are simply a tool, a bicycle for the mind. I would say that your education is a tool. Your education is a bicycle that gives you resources and skills that will help you formulate questions and seek answers for the rest of your life. A bicycle that will never, if consistently used and exercised, will fail you. A bicycle that has the ability to see you rise to great heights and accomplish much, not only for yourself, but for all of those that surround you. So congratulations, again, you just bought a bike. Again, it doesn't matter what you did yesterday in college or in your previous jobs or your internships or your battles. What matters is that you realize you have acquired tools. And lastly, and perhaps most importantly, is how you are going to use them. And that brings me to my third point, which is passion. How will you use those tools? With what energy? Bicycle or no bicycle, all animals need fuel. Fuel to get up and go to school, to go to work, or if you're a lion, to go hunt. There are different kinds of fuel. What motivates you? It's an important question. Fear is certainly a powerful fuel or motivator. Fear of failing a class, fear of getting fired, or fear of starvation and death. I'm not a fan of fear, however, and neither will you be if you want to succeed. It takes a certain amount of fearlessness to achieve anything beyond survival. I would rather talk about passion. As you know, because I told you, I had a whole other career before becoming a cheesemaker. I liked what I did in my previous career. I enjoyed it. I was driven, and I was successful at it. But I wasn't passionate about it. I worked hard, sometimes spending the night at the office if that's what it required, but I didn't love it. It didn't stir that place in me that has fire inside. Following my passion for food, seeking out the thing, the place, the work that reached that place in me that has fire inside has made all the difference in the world. Not Frost's path less taken, but rather my path to passion. And I don't mean in terms of work being a source of joy, although that is enough. I became a cheesemaker not because I had any knowledge of it, a history around it even. That's if you don't count all those Greeks in the food industry, please. I became a cheesemaker, because it inspired me. Following my passion for food, not caring about what I had done before, and knowing I had adequate tools, my education, landed me in Fortune magazine, on the pages of Success magazine, awarded me Entrepreneur of the Year, and finally, I think, the coup of all, for a woman who has never taken a single business course in her life, got me invited to speak at Harvard Business School on entrepreneurialism. Be passionate about what you do. Find that thing that sets you on fire, and the entire world will benefit. Here's an important point about passion, though. Please don't interpret my sentiments on following your passion with rose-colored glasses. Following your passion doesn't make your work easier. In fact, following your passion might make your work harder. It might make your work harder because you will perhaps not even have a roadmap. You may be forging entirely new ground. Maybe following your passion will mean that, like Thomas Edison, you will fail 10,000 times before you succeed. That's stamina, don't you think? Steve Jobs talks a good deal about passion, and in one recorded speech, he detailed that without passion, he would have quit because it's hard. The thing you desire most is hard. So when I talk about passion and loving what you do, I am not saying it won't be hard. I'm just saying it will be worth it. Those are my 3 points. My 3 pieces of wisdom for you to take with you into your next new chapter of life. But I have one little bonus, extra credit. Maybe it's the last time you have to hear those words. Don't be afraid to fail. Sarah Blakely, again, the youngest female billionaire who now finds herself sharing space with Bill Gates and Warren Buffett, was schooled on failure. She was raised on it, even. Your extra credit is not about her success. It is about failure, or rather the fear of failure. Sarah talks a lot about how her father encouraged her and her brother about failure. And every week at the dinner table, she tells a story. She and her brother would come home and her father would say, "What did you fail at today?" And if they said nothing, he'd say, "Oh, that's too bad." What he was going for is that trying or attempting something new and unknown is what even, or especially, what matters, even if it means failing. She was given constant reassurance that the real failure was in not trying, and this allowed her to be free in trying things without the fear of outcome. You will not succeed by being afraid. So in conclusion, don't look behind you because it doesn't matter. Use the tools that you have and seek your passion and you will be rewarded. 3 tiny little things. That's it. That's all. Now go have fun.
Well, now we come to the part of the ceremony that you have all been waiting for. Would the candidates from the College of Arts and Sciences please stand? Dr. Glenn, the candidates whose names will be called today have met all the requirements necessary to receive the degree Bachelor of Arts or Bachelor of Science. On behalf of the faculty, I recommend their degrees be conferred.
By the authority granted to me by the State of Alabama and vested in me by the Board of Trustees of Athens State University, I hereby confer upon each of you the degree of Bachelor of Arts or Bachelor of Science with all the rights, privileges, and responsibilities thereunto appertaining. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you the graduating class of Athens State University. Please be seated. I need to give you just a word of instruction before we get started. In just a moment, Dr. Engel will call you forward and you will come row by row at the direction of the marshal. You'll come across, give your card to Dr. Long, who will call your name colorfully, and then you'll walk across the stage. You'll find me. You will have to shake my hand. You don't get the degree without doing that. We will sit and we'll turn and smile at this nice young man here. He'll take your picture for your family and friends. You will walk back to that corner, have another picture taken. And then if there are others who want to have their pictures taken, I suggest along the wall here is the best place. I would remind you that we have an area set up in the northeast corner of the hall after the ceremony. You're welcome to take pictures there or come up on the stage and take as many pictures as you would like. This is your day. Take as many as you'd like. Stay as long as you'd like. The faculty will be waiting for you right outside if you'd like to have your picture taken with them. And now, if you will, please follow the instructions of Dr. Engel and your marshal, and we look forward to shaking your hand and conferring your degree.
Will the candidates from the College of Arts and Sciences please come forward and join Dean Ron Fritzy to receive your diplomas? Please hold your applause until we have completed awarding degrees to all of the recipients. Please come forward.
Margaret Frances Andrews. Robert K. Atchison. Rebecca Lee Bates. Lindsay Carol Beatty. Jamario L. Bell. Heather Leanne Berry. Thomas J. Berry, magna cum laude. Jared M. Boyd, magna cum laude. Matthew Trent Brooks. Jacqueline Nicole Brown, cum laude. Emily A. Campbell, summa cum laude. Madison Danielle Chambers, magna cum laude. Ashley Michelle Chrisman. Amanda Haley Coleman. Jesse Dwayne Colwell, cum laude. Kelsey Turner Cooper, magna cum laude. Patrick Michael Cornell. Christy Lena Coughlin. Victoria Counts. William Joseph Cummings IV, cum laude. Jonathan James Dowen, magna cum laude. Jana Lindsay Lee. Sabra Ann Davis, magna cum laude. Kimberly Lynn Dove. Mariah Miranda Duracek. Haley A. Flanagan, cum laude. John P. Flanagan. Loriana Morgan Fortenberry, summa cum laude. Casey Wayne Gaddis, magna cum laude. Rachel Greathouse, magna cum laude. Justin Alexander Guy. Rhonda P. Call, magna cum laude. Zachary Evans Harbin. Jonathan Michael Harden. Stasha Medina Harwell, cum laude. James Richard Haynes. Casey Lee Hillis. Emily Jane Holcomb. Linda Marie Howe, summa cum laude. Brittany Nicole Isom, cum laude. Forrest, always on time, Preston Johnson. Joshua Blaine King. Taquina Hood King. Alvatice Shantaria Lang. Nicholas Barlow Looney, magna cum laude. Jasmine Danielle Malone. Leah Kimberly Maples. Trinita R. March. Michelle Lee McCarthy. Anthony Scott Michael, magna cum laude. Jeffrey Lynn Mobbs. Justin Kyle Morrow. Eric Murphy, magna cum laude. Kayla Danielle Neely. Ashley Dawn Osborne. Jonathan Ray Parsons. Allison Blair Partlow, cum laude. Catherine Leah Pease, magna cum laude. Jessica P. Peppers. Natasha M. Petway. Jamie Lee Phillips. Bridget Ann Pilant, summa cum laude. Gosh, make it all. Patricia Elizabeth Reinhardt. Nikisha Elaine Robinson, cum laude. Audra Louise Roby, magna cum laude. Jeremy Kent Rogers, cum laude. Aaron Dene Romero. Robert Blair Shaw, cum laude. Leslie Benefield Shockley. Brandy Nicole Sims, magna cum laude. Rebecca Ann Sims. Sarah Montine Stevens, summa cum laude. Katie Elizabeth Taylor. L. Renee Thomas, cum laude. Miranda L. Thomas, summa cum laude. Jacqueline N. Wallace. Ashlyn Page West, magna cum laude. Cameron Dallas Williams. Marlene M. Williams, magna cum laude. Kevin T. Woods, magna cum laude.
Ladies and gentlemen, the graduating class of Athens State University. Please be seated. Well, you missed it. You got your first standing ovation. Congratulations. There are just two more things that we need to mention to you before we let you loose. The first is it's important to remember that you are here today surrounded by the people who brought you here both literally and figuratively. These are people who have sacrificed for you, who've worked for you, who've helped you in every way they can think of to help you. They have gotten you to this point. Don't leave here today without saying thank you. The mark of an educated person is to know when to be grateful and to know when to say thank you. Do not leave this place without saying thank you. Now, I mean it. If I find out you didn't, I will hunt you down. I will take your degree back. Don't leave here today without saying thank you. Hold them close. This is As Dr. White mentioned so eloquently at the beginning, this is a special moment. Take full advantage of it. The second thing is, as each graduate comes through, I tell them one thing. Now go and do good work. Again, if you wonder why, it's really very simple. This is called commencement. It's not called conclusion. You start today. Your speaker did a wonderful job of talking to you about going out and finding your passion and working hard. And I remind you that you have a responsibility to this institution to do so. You stand on the shoulders of all of those who have gone before you. Many of you came here because you had heard that this was a good place to go, a great university. And it is a great university. A great university gets a person from wherever they are to wherever they need to be. And I hope you would agree with me that this is a great university. But the proof is in the pudding, and you're the pudding. When you go out every day, people will look at you and they will see what this institution is capable of producing. So go out and do good work. We are proud of what you have done. We are proud of what you've accomplished, but we expect to be prouder yet of what you will do. So go and do good work. Now please stand. There is one last thing that you need to do. Please move your tassels to the left. If I could ask the audience to stand. Would the audience stand, please? I'm going to ask the audience to stand. We're going to conclude the ceremony with the singing of the alma mater. Now, I know all of my graduates know all the words to the alma mater, but for those of you who may not, just look on the back of your program, and there you'll find them. Graduates, little hint, I will be looking to see if your lips are moving. We're going to end with the singing of the alma mater, which will be led by Clarissa Lovern, and then that will be followed by a benediction by Dr. Robert White. And we would ask that you remain standing for the recessional of the platform party and the graduates. Thank you, and again, graduates, congratulations.
Alabama's northern border,
May the words of the psalmist be our benediction. May the Lord set your feet in a broad place, so that your experience of life does not grow narrow and rigid with the passing of time. But instead may you experience the wideness of God's mercy and the depth of grace. May you sense the freedom to stretch and dream and grow, learn and explore. May you live and love truly and deeply. May your life be filled with joy. May your work be filled with passion and purpose. May you continue to grow and learn with the passing years. May your light shine with God's peace and love. May the Lord bless you and keep you now and forever. Amen.